Hi everyone, I'm Chris Broadfoot. I'm an engineer on the Google Maps Developer Relations team.
Hi, I'm Marcelo. I'm the lead engineer on the Place API.
Now, as part of Developer Relations, I talk to a lot of developers, and I meet many that use the Google Places API. Some of them have a few questions, and it's great to have you today. So the first question is, when do I need to provide my developer key?
So you always have to provide a developer key when you're using the Web Service API. You don't have to use the key when you're using the JS API, but you can use it if you're on the track usage on the developer console.
Okay, cool. So you mentioned the JavaScript API. What's the difference between the JavaScript API and the web service?
So the main difference is that the JavaScript API can be used directly within the browser. And the web service, on the other hand, can be accessed from any platform using the programming language of your choice. Some services like place reports, check-ins, and events are only accessible via the web service API though.
Okay, so another one I get frequently is, can I call the Places API endpoints directly from my mobile app?
Well, technically you can. Most mobile development platforms allow you to create the web service directly. But doing this may risk leaking your developer key, and you don't want that to happen because it may lead to someone else using your key and using up your quota or spamming your service.
So speaking of quota, how do I get more than the courtesy limit of 1,000 requests per day?
Well, you have to go to the developer consoles and enable billing on your Places API project. Doing so will lift your quota to 100,000 requests per day. The developer console will ask for your credit card details, but we only use that for identification purposes.
Okay, so will my credit card ever be charged?
So no, we do not charge for the access to the Places API. If at any point in the future we start offering an option to pay for extra quota, they'll be done on top of the existing free quotas, and you have to explicitly sign up for it.
Okay, so since I can't buy more quota today, what if my app's really popular and I need more than 100,000 requests per day?
Well, if that's the case, you can request additional quota, and to do that, you search for the quota uplift form, and we receive those requests. We look through each one of them. We love getting them because it means people are using the Place API and liking it, and we try to reply to every single one.
Okay, so say I have a lot of places. Can I add them in bulk through the API?
So that's not exactly the use case of the Places API. We don't have a functionality for bulk upload of places. And the main purpose of the API is to get input from the end user.
So another one I get really often is from store managers. They have really good data about all the stores. So how can they make sure they get them into Google Plus local?
Again, this is not the main use case of Places API. If you have good data about your stores, you have to upload them through the Google Places Manager tool on places.google.com/manage.
Okay, so another one people get about usage is, how do I use the sensor parameter?
All right, so the idea with the sensor parameter is to tell us where you get your location data from. So if you're doing a search and the location came from, say, the phone GPS or Wi-Fi location service, you must set the sensor to true. On the other hand, if the search location is not coming from a sensor, for instance, if the user is pointing a location on a map, you should be setting the sensor to false. We only use that value for information purposes only, and it will not influence your results in any way.
Okay, so a lot of queries to the Places API returns references and IDs, and they both appear to be unique. What's the difference?
So that's a question we get a lot. So on the Places API, we split the place ID into two separate attributes, the place reference and the place ID. The place reference you use to fetch details of a place or to reference a place when you're doing a check-in or adding an event to it. The place ID you use to tell whether two places are the same and also for indexing content to a place.
So I notice the reference changes on each request I do to the API. So I'll probably use the ID as a foreign key and use the reference to retrieve more details. Should I be storing other place data as well?
You can cache place data for up to 30 days, but you don't really want to keep the data for much longer than that because it goes out of date really quickly. And you can use the reference to refresh your data.
Okay. So another thing I notice is I get attributions from where the data came from. Do I need to display these?
Only if you're going to be compliant to your terms of service, and I recommend that you do. That's the first thing we're going to look if you apply for a quota uplift.
Okay, so another great feature of the API are check-ins. So developers ask me, what are they for? What can I use them for?
So the check-ins give the place API extra signals about the relevance of a place, and we can use those signals to improve search results and make them more relevant to users.
Okay.
So developers should send a check-in whenever the user has executed an action that tells us that a place result is useful for them.
Okay, so I might get more relevant search results if I use check-ins. How are search results ranked usually?
So by default, we use a ranking algorithm called permanence, and it uses a number of different signals. For instance, how popular a place is, the number of reviews it has, its ratings, number of check-ins, and other stuff as well.
Okay, so there's a bit of magic going on there.
Absolutely.
So some developers don't want magic, and they just want to find the closest place. How can they do that?
That actually also requires magic. But there is a switch that we call the rank by switch, and you can use it to toggle between getting results ranked by permanence or getting results ranked by distance.
Okay, magic seems to be what Google's good at.
We try.
Okay, so one of my favorite features is autocomplete. Developers ask me, how can I customize the look and feel of autocomplete?
So we use CSS to do all our styling. So developers can override the .pack container and .pack item classes in their CSS to change the look and feel of autocomplete.
Okay, so that's it for developer questions. I just have one of my own while I've got you here. So that is, what are the kind of apps that you'd like to see developers build?
Okay, so we do have the expectations that the Place API will enable an entire ecosystem of location-based apps. I love to see developers going beyond just offering suggestions for restaurants and dealing with places like art galleries, maybe about urban graffiti, apps for families, apps for kids, maybe apps about sports. I also want to see apps that help users accomplish very specific tasks. And especially I'm looking for apps that where developers have put their local expertise and knowledge into the place results.
Great, I'm really looking forward to developers create these kind of applications. I think the Google Places API is a really great way to add a dimension of local data to applications. Thanks so much for answering these developer questions. I'm really looking forward in the future to see what you add to the Google Places API.
Thanks, Chris.